Hello. Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Hi, good morning. Yes, we can hear you.
Hello? If you can hear me, can you text? Yes. Okay, great. So today it's oncology lesson.
维基百科的资料如下。
This topic is cancer hallmarks, bench to bedside. I think you already had the PDF, the slides before the lesson. So we will go through all the slides and let me know any question, and you can just text in chat or interrupt me anytime. Is it okay? Okay. So I don't know how many you guys will come, but now it's already 100, 100, oh, 100. I think it's already almost most of you in the room, right? Okay, let's start. So today my lecture is three parts, includes three parts. First, I will give you a basic introduction of cancer. And the second part is to characterize the cancer as a genetic disease. And the last part is the core of this lesson. We will talk about the cancer hallmarks. And I believe it's the landscape of the cancers and the fundamental components you need to know about cancer. Can you is the volume is okay? Can you hear me clearly? Okay. Okay, it's clear. Okay. Okay, good. Okay. So what is cancer? First we need to give a definition, right? And when we talk about cancer, we might think of a mass. So there are several a mass and with unlimited growth. So for that, we can see the three terms. One is uncontrolled growth. This is a unique feature of cancers. So when we talk about cancer, we will think it's a uncontrolled division of abnormal cells and in the tissue, in the organ. And second, what's tumor? Tumor is about the swelling of a part of the body, and generally without inflammation, but occasionally it can be with inflammation, and it caused by an abnormal growth of tissue, and whether benign or malignant. So, here, please, to remember that when we talk about tumor, when one day when you go to the clinics, When you communicate with clinicians or other scientists or technicians, when talk about tumor, the term is neutralized. It doesn't mean it's not necessarily is malignant. It can be benign. The tumor just mentioned about one mass. Although most of the time, when we talk about tumor, we might think it's malignant. But actually, by cautious definition, it's not necessarily be malignant. It can be benign or malignant. Okay. And the third is new present. It's also means a new and abnormal growth of tissue in some part of the body. Okay, so when we talk about neoplasm, it also can be benign or malignant. Okay, so cancer is a genetic disease. Usually, it's caused by an accumulation of detrimental variation in the genome, and the key is all the accumulation of the genetic variation, like mutations or deletion, insertion, they must happen over a certain of time period. That means cancers is not a sudden happened episode. It developed with several genetic variants and the interaction with the our environment. Okay, so because it need time, so you can quickly think about the age. Usually, age is the most strong risk factor of cancers. Although some cancers happened in the certain young age, they have some reason. Usually, it's quite strong association with the family history and the inherited disease. So, except for this part, most sporadic cancers develop with age. Okay, so most of time a single mutation is not sufficient to induce cancer formation. When we talk about cancer types, there are four main types. One is carcinoma. Carcinoma is the most common histology type of cancer in our body. It arises in epithelial tissues, and you can see it can be adenocarcinoma developed in the gland tissue. Another is squamous cell carcinoma. It developed in the squamous epithelium, like skin, esophagus, and lung. So for the carcinoma, the two most common types are adenocarcinoma and the squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, and the carcinoma composed to more than 90% of the cancers in our body. However, there are other relatively uncommon cancer types. One is sarcoma. Sarcoma arrives from the stroma tissue. It's not from the epithelial tissue. So you can image that sarcoma arrives from the stroma tissues, like bones and tendons or other cartilage muscle. So it's stroma. And another are liquid cancers. is leukemia and the lymphoma. Oh, although lymphoma can be also the mass formation, but we classify the leukemia and the lymphoma as the liquid cancer, hematologic malignancy. Okay. Okay, so the next I want to show you some slides to see the example, the real example of the pathology, the pathological feature of the cancers. Here in the slide, you can see large and the normal glands with the epithelial lining. And we can see the upper parts. They are more condensed tissues. Here is the cancer. Here is the cancer happens. You can see the normal gland, and then you can see the low grade cancer and the high grade cancer. You can see in the cancer part, the normal lining of the gland lining already disrupted, and instead it replaced by many cells with condensed cellularity. And in the C, it's clear sample of the sarcoma. It's a Ewing sarcoma. On the left, you can see the normal connective tissue with lots of the space between the cells. And on the right, you can see the cancer is just uncontrolled growth. And you can see proliferation of cells. You can see bigger nuclei, the cells with bigger nuclei here. They don't look normal. Okay. So here is an obvious difference between the left and the right side. Okay. And in the D, it's an example of the acute lymphoblastic leukemia. In the background, you can see the red blood cells. But we focus on the leukemia cells. You can see they just a proliferation, what we call blast, and the overgrowth of cells with bigger nuclei and bigger cytoplasm. And this is what acute lymphoblastic leukemia looks like. Okay. And in the E is an example of a mantle cell lymphoma. And again, you can see that in the picture is an overgrowth of cells, and they are out of shape. There are different shapes and different sizes. It's totally affected by the, in the lymph node, it's totally affected. But it's nothing, just cancer cells, okay? So when we talk about the most common cancers worldwide, there are several cancers you can have, you should have remember this. First is the breast cancer, and the second is prostate cancer. And the third is the lung cancer. And the following is the colorectal cancer, cervical cancer, gastric cancer, and liver cancer, and so on. So first, we talk about lung cancer. According to the WHO reports, lung cancer is the most common cancer Can you hear me? Lung cancer is the most common cancer in men and women. And approximately 200,000 diagnoses per year. And so, and for the whole the world population, it's somewhere between 1.5 and 2 million people. Okay, so it's a leading cause of cancer death, and 85% lung cancer are non-small cell cancers. And among the non-small cell lung cancer, the most is adenocarcinoma. And then the second most common is squamous cell carcinoma. It's about 25%. Okay. So the next is the risk factors for the lung cancer. So what's the risk factor? If you want to have only memory about lung cancer, you just know the smoking. Smoking, smoking, smoking. 87 lung cancer deaths in men and 70 in women are likely caused by smoking. So smokers has a much higher risk to develop lung cancer with 25 times higher. So many other lung cancers are linked to secondhand smoke. So okay, so you must know that when we talk about risk factor of lung cancer, it's smoking. Okay, others like other chemical exposure, asbestos, arsenic, radioactive ores, others inhaled chemicals, they also can cause the lung cancer. Okay, so about the lung cancer prevention and the screening, the first important thing is we should stop people smoking, okay, and decreasing any secondhand smoke exposure. And when we talk about the screening, now it's already very common, and in the USA, they ask people with high risk, for example, smokers, to have low dose CT scan every year. And also in Taiwan, we also have clinical studies, and in Taiwan we are almost about going to announce the low dose CT scan to screen lung cancer, probably in late this year. So let's turn to the colon cancer. Colon cancer is the third most common cancer in the world. It's also the third leading cause of cancer deaths. And most primary colon cancer are adenocarcinoma. Okay. So but you can see here the cancer death, the number is almost half of the diagnosis and the new cases per year. That's because if we catch the primary colon cancer earlier, you can see showing here, there are here in the picture is a ulcerating mass inside the colon. And So we can actually remove all the tumor with surgery, and then we might have a big chance to cure people. So therefore, being diagnosed with colon cancer earlier, it can be cured. So that's why the deaths caused by the colon cancer is decreasing. So the risk factor for the colon cancer, well, still age. Age is the important factors. And then it's diet. Okay? When we talk about diet, high in red meats and the low in the fiber diet, this kind of lifestyle can lead to the development of colon cancer. Okay. And then it's other lifestyle like obesity, smoking, and alcohol. And it's also noted that this kind of contribute to a higher risk of colon cancer. And the others, if you have a history of inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn, or ulcerative colitis disease, that chronically inflammation over time, they can all can contribute to colon cancer. And others, if you have a positive family history, okay, it's almost double risk if you have one affected first degree relatives. And when we talk about gene, there are several genes that can be inherited and can affect your risk of colon cancer. These genes include the DNA repair gene like KRAS and P53. Okay. So colon cancer prevention, it's very clear that a high fiber diet and a low red meat diet is associated with decreased risk of developing colon cancer. Others, they also say the low dose aspirin might have a possibility for the colon cancer prevention. Okay, the colon cancer screening, the way to screen is very clear. Colonoscopy is the gold standard for the screening. This is the most effective way to identify colon cancer early to remove polyps. And when they are on their way to becoming cancer, and it is very effective. Others potential, you can try the stool occult blood test. It's simple and quick, and it also can for the large scale screening. So for the country or regions that colonoscopy is not so feasible, stool occult blood test is also a good alternative test for colon cancer screening. And others is similar, stool DNA test. And also you can use sigmoid scopy, not the whole colon scopy. And others like the barium enema, but now it's an old technique. Nowadays, we don't use this kind of radiographic tool. So, here in the picture, you can see the breast cancer. It's a surgical specimen. So we talk about the breast cancer. It's the most common cancer in women in the whole world, and the second leading cause of cancer death. And breast cancer you can see it's classified by the location and the histologic subtypes. Up to 70 to 80% infiltrating ductal cancers, followed by lobular and the nipple cancers. So what's a risk factor for breast cancer? Again, age. So you can find the one in eight women have the breast cancer under 45. But when we talk about the woman aged over 55, then the most breast cancer it happen. Two-thirds breast cancer cases in this age. And for the family history, it's very strong, especially when you have one first degree relatives with breast cancer. Okay, it can doubles a woman's breast cancer risk. And when we talk about gene, the BRCA1, and please remember this gene because it's strong associated with the breast cancer, which when you have this gene mutation, loss of function, that will increase the risk by 55 to 65%. And the other BRCA gene, the BRCA2, also increase the risk by about 45%. So loss of function of the BRCA1 or BRCA2 has a very strong association with the breast cancer. Okay, so the other is the dense breast cancer tissue is also risk factor. Because it makes mammogram, which are screen test, it will make the screen test less accurate. And others, lifestyle is also important contributor to breast cancer, such as obesity, physical inactivity, alcohol use, or others. Okay. So when we talk about breast cancer prevention, actually we have we don't have any effective strategy, except for the prophylactic mastectomy in the high risk woman. And you can see some famous example in the, like for example in the Hollywood. Okay, so the possibilities, we use the high fiber and low fat diet, and staying in the physical activity, and maintaining normal weight, reduce the body weight. So the breast cancer screening usually is monthly self-examination by women, every month, and usually at the same time every month. And you can also have a yearly examination by the doctors and the mammograms. And others potential screening technique, the more advanced like tool like MRI and ultrasound is also developing. But still, currently, the self-examination, the yearly examination by doctors, the mammogram, still remain the gold standard. Okay, so let's talk about the prostate cancer. Just like breast cancer is the most common cancer in women, prostate cancer is the most common cancer in men. Okay. One in seven men in the US can will be diagnosed in their lifetime. And it's caused the second leading cause of cancer deaths in men. Okay, so for the risk factors, again, it's age, a disease occurring mainly in older men. Okay, here I think many of you might feel sleepy. So can you answer me? Give me an answer. What's the most important risk factors for the cancers we just talked about? Please test the answer to the chat room. Okay. Age, yes. But I also see some have other answers, right? Yeah, good. Lifestyle and the family history. Yeah. Okay. So the most common shared risk factor among all the common cancers is age. The age is the most common sharing risk factors of all the most important cancers. But for the individual cancer, they have other individual risk factors. So when you say the genetic or family history or lifestyle, they also can be reasonable in individual cancers. For example, in the breast cancer, family history or the gene BRCA1 or BRCA2 is also very important, strong risk factors for the breast cancer. Okay. Yeah. And as you say, exposure to some substance like in lung cancer, although age is still a important risk factor, but smoking exposure will cause have a bigger chance to lead into the lung cancer. Okay, so let's go back to the prostate cancer. Again, the family history is also important. And some certain genes also involved in the pathogenesis of prostate cancer, okay? Like the HOXB13 and BRCA1, 2, they can also contribute to the prostate cancer in men. And the other DNA repair gene like MSH2 and MLH1, okay? And for the diet, high in red meat, low in vegetable, again, is an important contribution to prostate cancer. So here, can you give me the answer? What kind of the diet style lead to the tumor? What kind of diet style? Can you text in the chat room? Yeah, okay. Okay, thanks for your response. It's very, yeah. Okay, so I think everyone remember this, and you can talk to your family, your friends, and others the basic principle that we should avoid the high red meat, high fat diet. Instead, we should increase the vegetables amount and the high fiber diet, right? Okay. Okay, let's go to the prostate cancer prevention. No known proven strategies, but we can lower the possibility by changing our lifestyle. For example, we use the high fiber, low fat diet. And again, staying physically active. It's important. If we can have more physical activity, more exercise, it also can maintain a good lifestyle to reduce the risk to many diet-related cancers, such as prostate cancer, colon cancer, breast cancer, okay? And also important thing is maintaining normal weight, which you can do this by maintaining a good diet style and keep the physical activity. Okay, for the screening, we should do the digital rectal examination after age 50. And also you can have the PSA blood test. Okay. And now we talk a little bit about the liver cancer. Why? Because liver cancer, although it's also one of the most common cancer, but actually it's more about Asia, mainly in Southeast Asia. Okay. Including like China, Taiwan, and also Thailand, and of course Malaysia is also kind of Southeast Asia. So we should know more about this liver cancers. It's also a leading cause of cancer deaths worldwide. And you should notice how lethal this cancer is. It's high with high mortality, because the number of deaths almost equal to the number of diagnoses. And that's because if liver cancer diagnosed, usually it's too late to be able to cure with surgery or other local therapy. Okay, so in the picture you can see a mass growing in the liver. It's generally not detectable until it causes the obstruction to bile or some symptomatic like abdominal pain, which is too late to do anything about it. So what are the risk factors for liver cancers? Male is predominant, okay? It's almost twice common in the male. And the other risk factors, such as viral hepatitis, hepatitis B or hepatitis C, and alcohol. These are the most common risk factors. So when you hear someone you know, maybe your family or your friends, it's so sad, right? But if you hear they have liver cancer, you can try to check the possible causes. First, is female or male, right? And then check if he has the hepatitis B or hepatitis C, and then check the alcohol if it has alcoholic hepatitis. Okay. And others, other chemical like the aflatoxin, is also a well known well known the chemical will lead into the liver cancer. Okay, others lifestyle is so similar to other cancers. So liver cancer prevention, we can prevent the treat hepatitis infection and avoid alcohol abuse, right? Okay, about the liver cancer screening. If you have the high risk factor like chronic hepatitis or chronic alcoholism, you may check the liver ultrasound every 6 to 12 months with the alpha fetal protein blood test. Okay, so let's go to the second part of the it's about the cancer is disease. Do you want to a break? 5 minutes short break? If you want, please answer yes and or no. I can see the how many you are. Okay. Only one? Only one answer yes? Or you want to continue? Okay, yes. Then we have 5 minutes break and then we come back, okay? Okay, thank you. Okay. Okay, we are going to start. Okay, so do you come back, everyone? Okay, great. So, let's talk about the cancer in a different approach. We are going to the molecular level. I try to give you some basic introduction of cancers in the molecular level. So first, we are talking about some common terms you will hear in the future frequently. One is SNV, is single nucleotide variation. One is SNP, is single nucleotide polymorphism. And others you might hear when you talk about the tumor cancer, you will see you might hear about the variation mutations and what are these. When we talk about SNV, it's a substitution of a single nucleotide for another. And SNV means sometimes SNV known about as a single nucleotide polymorphism, SNP. But remember that SNV and SNP is not interchangeable. So you might ask, oh, so what's the difference between SNP and the I didn't share. Oh, sorry. Did you see the screening? Okay. Okay. Okay, now you can see the screen, right? Okay, same. Okay. So for the SNV, SNP, and there's so many genetic variation like SNV and insertion, deletion, and structure variants, copy number variation. Oh. You just need to know the some simple definition. For the insertion, deletion, when we talk about insertion, deletion, the indel. We are talking about the less than 25 base pairs, right? Here, I don't know if you can see. Can you see the pen in the slide?
We still can't see the slide.
Oh, cannot see the slide. Okay, sorry. Let me check. Okay. So now it's clear, right?
Yes.
Okay. So you can see here. it's hard to use. Can you see the arrow?
Doctor, you are muted, we can't hear you.
Okay, so now you can hear me? Yeah,
yes.
Okay, good. So for the insertion deletion, here you can see the deletion means part of the DNA is deleted, and for the insertion, it means here you can see the cartoon. Part of the DNA is inserted with a new fragment. So, for the insertion deletion, when we talk about indel, it's about less than 25 base pair change. It might be inserted or deleted. And for the structural variants, it's, we are talking about a bigger fragment alteration. It could be more than 50 base pairs change. Okay. And the copy number variation is about a even bigger, it might be more than 500 base pair variation. So, but the variation can be increase or loss. So when we talk about copy number variation, it can be increased, for example, the amplification, and it can be decreased. So it can be loss of the copy number. Okay. Okay, next. So variation and the SNP and the SNP and the SNV. I think it's difficult to explain very clearly to you, but I would like to give you a sense by this cartoon. That means when we talk about variation, it can be many different different kinds of variation, right? It can be insertion or deletion or mutation and copy number, whatever. So it's a bigger, area. And when we talk about SNV, it's one kind of variation. So it's a single nucleotide variation. And when we talk about SNP, it's included in the SNV, but it's talking about a population level. Usually it's about more than 1% single nucleotide substitution detected in the population level. Okay, then the second common important concept is about cancer gene. So what's cancer genes? When we talk about cancer genes, usually we divide it to two types. One is oncogenes. Oncogene promote cancer. So in a normal healthy cell, expression of oncogene, usually in a normal healthy cancer, the expression is low. On a cancer cell, expression of oncogene is high. And this is in contrast to tumor suppressor, which protect against cancer. So in normal cells, you have high expression of tumor suppressor, and in cancer cell, in cancer cells, you would have low expression of tumor suppressors. Okay. So you can see here, it's a street and many cars here. You to prevent a crash, you need to both accelerate with the gas or stop with the brakes. But important thing is the balance of the two. This is true in the normal cells. However, so in the cancer cells, the gas is oncogene and the brakes are tumor suppressed. And in cancer cells, these are both dysregulated. Okay. So there are two types of mutations. One is activating mutation. That means it causes the gene to overexpressed at the wrong time, at the wrong level. So that means they're activating in the oncogene and they make the cells to be tumorigenic. They converse inactivating mutations, and they may cause reduced function of a gene or a lost function of a gene. So either less RNA or protein is made. So inactivating mutation in the tumor suppressors, they also can be tumorigenic. Okay. So what do mutation come from? Every time when a cell divides, it must replicate its DNA, and the arrow just get made by chance. So you will remember what we talked about before. We know the DNA that can be mutated, and it's just by chance about one mutation is made every 10 billion base pairs, and they will increase in DNA damage. And in the subsequent replication, the error, the replication error can contribute to this kind of DNA damage, such as it can cause by the radiation, chemicals, and others like infectious agents. Okay. So, someone might tell you about when someone will talk about a somatic mutation or germline mutations. So what's the definition? Somatic mutation it's just happened in the okay, let's start with germline mutation first. If you get mutations by inheriting name, and you came from your parents, then it's called germline mutations. In this mutation, the mutations are present in the germ cell. So in this case, the egg or the sperm are inherited by offspring. So it's just the genetic variation that we are born with. So when cancer is said to affect it in the family, it can be due to their inherited mutations. Okay, for example, the previous we mentioned the BRCA1, BRCA2 mutation are at increased risk for breast cancer. Okay. And the somatic mutation is acquired mutations. It doesn't come from a parent. It's acquired at some time later in your lifetime. It just started in one cell and then it's passed on to any new cells created from the cell during the proliferation. And this kind of mutation is not present in the egg or sperm cells. So it's not possible to pass to the next generation. Okay. So, and the acquired mutations are much more common than the inherited mutations. And most cancers are caused by acquired mutations. Okay. Also, on the right, the right panel I show here is the some generalized mutation well known to the cancers, leading to the cancer development. For example, the BRCA1 and BRCA2, they can go. If you have generalized mutation of these genes, you have a much high chance to have the hereditary breast and the ovarian cancer. And for the DNA repair gene, like MLH1, MSH2, and so on, these DNA repair gene, if you have the germline mutations of these genes, you have you might have a chance to have the Lynch syndrome at your early age. And others is like the TP53, okay? So cancer is driven by accumulation of the detrimental variations. And aging is the biggest risk factor of developing cancer. And here is the example of colorectal cancer. You can see normal mucosa, when they have some early event of mutation, such as APC, KRAS, or TP53, then they might have the pre-malignant change. And then if they have other genes contribution, they might have the malignant growth and eventually go to the metastasis. Okay. So also one concept is important. It's about two hit hypothesis. It's about the inherited mutations and plus somatic mutations. The two hit hypothesis is, remember that the human are diploid, right? We have two copies of every gene. One from mother is maternal and the one from father is paternal. That means that even if one copy of the gene or allele is mutated, the other copy still can allow the protein to function normally. So in order for a gene to be induce cancer, both copies of the gene must be affected. So the second so-called hit may alter the DNA directly by mutation, or it may alter the expression of the DNA through the epigenetic mechanism. So here we can talk about this example. We walk through the top three first. And you can see on the left, you can see a parent who with his paternal passed on two normal copies of a gene to their child, okay? And over the lifetime, this person, he accumulated mutations here the purple one. Okay. And yeah, and include one hit in the gene, and importantly, the other gene is still normal, right? But eventually, in the lifetime, if the patient, the individual acquire another mutation in the same gene, then it get attacked and it becomes a potential cancer causing genetic mutant. Okay. So most cancer requires mutation and multiple different types of genes. So in order to survive, a cancer cell must overcome normal regulation of self-proliferation and self-survival and the cellular communication. And okay, so each of these processes are tightly regulated in a normal cells by multiple redundant pathways. This means in order to become cancerous, a cell must accumulate mutations in multiple of these pathways. Okay. So cancer cells can show a great deal of genomic instability. And this in genomic instability, we describe how cell can survive and divide with higher rates of mutation than in normal cells. So here you can see in the normal cells, DNA replication error result in programmed cell death or apoptosis. That means when the DNA replication error cannot be fixed, the cell will start a mechanism. For example, the program cell death or apoptosis to lead the cell to death to avoid the cell to become a potential malignant. However, in the cancer cell, the DNA replication error, they don't care about to repair the replication error. They still continue to divide and passes the mutation. So that's the reason now when we see the cancer cells, usually they are, most of them are acquired a lot of mutations that we didn't see in the normal cells. And as the mutation in this repair pathway accumulate, the frequency of mutation in the cancer genomes increases. So it's go to the out of control of the growth and the never go to death. It becomes immortal. So okay. Okay, so let's go to the last section. It's about cancer hallmarks. Yeah, before any question about this section? The cancer as a genetic disease. We can have 5 minutes if you have any question. Okay, if you don't have a question, then maybe I ask a question. When we say when we say the cancer is a genetic disease, okay, let's say if your friend or family ask you, is cancer is a genetic disease, can you explain in just one or two sentence to explain to them why cancer is a genetic disease? Okay, give me your answer in a text in the chat room. If you have any answer. Yeah. Yes. It's caused by, you can see, you can say it's tons of mutation, although it's not so a lot, but yeah. The meaning is correct. Comparing to the normal cells, it usually has several several mutations, yes. Yep. So is it due to germline mutation? The answer is correct, but germline mutation just account for part of cancers. For many cancers, they are sporadic. That means they are not caused by the germline mutation. They're caused by the somatic mutations. Yeah. Yeah, I think the Lu Yimun, yeah, this one. Sorry, I don't know how to pronounce, but I think this is correct. It's accumulation gene mutations and cause cancer. Yeah. Okay, great. So if we don't have any problem, then we go to the next section. It's cancer hallmark. Okay, so what's cancer hallmarks? This is the cartoon. This is the picture. Probably the most important one in this lesson. Okay. If you don't remember anything from this lecture, you just keep a memory that the 10 hallmarks is the fundamental of the cancer development, and also the theory included here is the is very fundamental to guide us to explore the cancer research and also guide us to develop the drug to fighting cancers. So it's for the hallmark of cancer is presented in the it's almost 10 years ago, okay, in 2011. By the Robert Weinberg, he is a very famous scholar in the Harvard, he provided the hallmarks concept to clearly dissect the cancer, what caused cancer. So previously, the Weinberg has six hallmarks. Okay, the six biological capability acquired during the multiple step development of human tumors. It included the sustaining proliferative signaling, and the second, evading growth suppressors. Okay, and resisting cell death and enabling replicative immortality, and others, including angiogenesis and activating invasion and metastasis. Okay, so underlying these hallmarks are genome instability, which generate the genetic diversity. Okay, but after several years development, we know the cancers more. So later they add four whole marks to generate the new 10 whole marks pictures. What's the new four whole marks? It's two about emerging whole marks of about the energy metabolism and the evading immune destruction. Okay, and the others, let me check, and also the inflammation. Okay. So let's talk about the first hallmark is replicative immortality. We know the normal cells have a limited ability to undergo mitosis. And it's because the telomeres, because every division, the end of the chromosome, the telomeres, here you can see the cartoon, the pink one, it gets shorter. And to a certain point, they call the hair flex limits, they will reach senescence status. It's G0 phase, and then they go, then they stop to divide. However, in the cancer cell, they have high increased level of telomerase, and they can elongate the telomeres, and they can preventing this kind of limited ability. Okay, so the second hallmark is the genome instability. In a normal cell undergoing DNA synthesis during the cell cycle, if it detects mutation, which occur in the gap phases of the cell cycle, the cell is able to stop the cell cycle and repair the mutation and then re-enter the cell cycle. And genomic instability is a hallmark of cancer, arise from the inactivation of DNA repair pathway during tumorigenesis. For example, for the single strand arrow, we have four mechanisms to repair, but in the cancer cell, they have high probability that this repair mechanism are impaired. And for the double strand error, like we have the HR and the NHEZ or MMEZ, this kind of mechanism to fix the double strand error. However, in cancer cells, these mechanisms are also affected, and they might cause the impairment of double strand error repairment. So think of these genes are being in the brakes in your mobile automobile. If you see traffic coming, you put on the brakes to stop your car. However, cancer cells differ from normal cells due to their ability to bear an abnormal amount of chromosomes within the nucleus and also still be able to undergo mitosis. So genes that are mutated in cancer or lost in cancers contribute to genome instability. Okay. So these are your breaks. They are the known as the tumor suppressor genes. Okay, so here is the more complicated to show you how many genes to regulate the cell cycles. And here you can see the red square is the famous tumor suppressor genes. Okay, like the RB gene and the TP53 and then the CHK2. Okay. Okay, so let's go to the hallmark number four, resistant to cell death. Normal cells can initiate cell death, also known as apoptosis, in response to like DNA damage or DNA mutations or other cellular stress. However, cancer cell able to resist cell death by upregulating pro-survival proteins to avoid cell death. Okay, here we can see the pro-survival proteins, for example, the BCL2, BCL group, and MCL1. These are the anti-apoptotic proteins, and which usually increase the functions in the cancer cells. And on the other hand, in the among the pro-apoptotic proteins like BAK, BOK, okay, and also the in the down panel, the BIN, NOSA, BMF, HRK, or BED, BID, and the PUMA. These genes are pro-apoptotic proteins. However, these genes in the cancer types, we can see they are usually loss of functions. Okay, so cancer cells are very different, and they have the ability to proliferate and resist to cell death using the hallmark 1, 2, 4, as I mentioned before. Okay, they can use with loss of too much suppressor genes and increased expression of oncogenes, and they can resist to the cell death by dysregulated these proteins. These proteins are regulating the survival or apoptosis. Okay, so the next hallmark is the growth factor that's well studied in cancer research is called the epidermal growth factor. Here you can see, and from the you can see the ERB family here, the receptor, which is expressed on the cell surface, known as EGFR. They can activate an oncogene, the called ROS. Here is the ROS, and the ROS can have a downstream the signaling cascade, RAF, Merck, ERK, and then it can contribute to the cell growth. So this is very important and keep the cancer cell sustain the proliferation. And this is especially important because nowadays many our anti-cancer therapy is using this concept to develop, and we target the signal which can contribute to the sustained proliferation, and later we will talk about that. Okay, so the hallmark number six is the altered metabolism. Here we have a concept about cancer metabolism, because in the normal cell, usually we not only use glycolysis, we also use the TCA cycle to generate the ATP we needed. However, in the cancer cell, they don't go through the PCA cycle. Most commonly, they just depend on glycolysis and develop the and then generate the ATP. So Because the unique feature that the cancer cell using glycolysis most, and they don't use the TCA cycle as the main source of ATP production. So this concept translate to the clinics, the tool, the PET scan. Nowadays, it's already as a routine practice in the cancer staging or diagnosis. Here you can see the normal cell. You can see here the signal, high signal area is the tumor. And why they uptake more than the adjacent normal tissue? Because they use the glucose uptake. It's much higher than the neighboring the normal cells. So that's it's an example in the clinics. We using the PET scan to capture the tumor because the cancer cell have a higher glucose uptake. Okay, then our next hallmark, which is avoiding immune destruction. And this is a very, very hot spot in the recent 5 years, because many develop and get success. And nowadays, many of our patients can use the immunotherapy as one kind of tool to fight cancers. And here is the concept that in a tumor microenvironment, the immune cell they don't have the immune surveillance. They are exhausted. So the tumor, by interaction with the immune cell, for example, the T cell, and they using the checkpoint to stop the T cell, then they can escape from the immune check. So we know that to function properly, an immune system must detect a wide variety of agents from the either virus or cancer cells. And then to detect the antigen and then attack the abnormal cells. Okay. However, in the cancer cells, they try to stop this kind of immunosurveillance by using the immune checkpoint blockade. So that's why nowadays we develop the drug, for example, the anti-PD-L1 or anti-CTLA-4 antibody to release the break and refresh the T cell. And then we try to wake up the immune cells in the microenvironment, and then they can again to attack the tumor cells to function properly. Okay. So the next hallmark is the tumor promoting inflammation. It's also involved the immune system. So the tumor microenvironment is often infiltrated with adoptive immune cells that enable tumor to mimic inflammatory condition. And now we know that the tumor associated inflammation may help in help the tumor growth. And the inflammation seen in early stages in several neoplastic disease. So maybe how to control the abnormal inflammation is also a potential treatment target to stop cancer development. Okay, so let's introduction about the angiogenesis. A tumor cell requires a blood supply to grow to a significant size. And the cancer cells are able to do that by using pro-angiogenic factors, for example, the VEGF. By releasing this kind of cytokine, it becomes activated in tumor cells. And they can signal to the endothelial cells to grow and make new blood vessels, okay? And they can help the tumor to get the nutrition and the oxygen supply, and they will help the cancer cell growth. So the hallmark number 10, the activation of invasion and the metastasis. This is important to make the patient high lethal, because if tumor just develop locally, we can use the local therapy, for example, the surgery or radiotherapy to cure the patients. But the most nightmare thing is the metastasis. In the tumor cell, eventually they will go to the penetrate and break down the base membrane, and then go to the stroma, and finally they will find the blood vessel and go to circulating and try to clone in another part of body. It can be an organ, for example. They can go to the liver, causing liver metastasis, or lung metastasis, or brain. So this hallmark is very detrimental to us. However, we don't have currently we don't have much effective strategy to stop this. But this is the hallmark of the metastasis, and it's usually triggered by the MET signal. The EMT signal. So it's all involved in the MMP and the TGF beta and other growth factors that help the cancer cells moving on to the circulating system. Okay, so all these are the whole cancer hallmarks, including the 10 hallmarks. So I have give you a homework. Try to give me the to try to find one drug that is belong to the 10. One of the 10 hallmarks, and I don't know if you have any example. You can text in the chat room which drug you find and which hallmark is corresponding to the hallmarks. Okay, please answer your question in the using the text. Any example? I mean, yeah, it can be. It can be one drug but not cause tumor. I mean, any FDA approved anti-cancer drug. So the drug must be suppress the cancer. No. Okay, great. Edu said that erlotinib targets EGFR. Yeah, it's a very good example here. So erlotinib, it targets it's a TKI, EGFR TKI, and targets EGFR. So it's very obvious it belongs to the green one, right? Sustaining proliferative signaling and using the EGFR inhibitor. And one example is the erlotinib. Yeah, it's correct. So another student say the tamoxifen. Yes, tamoxifen is for breast cancer and it inhibits which receptor? Do you know? Oh yeah, let's come in another example is bevacizumab. Yeah, bevacizumab inhibits the VEGF. So which one you think which hallmark you think it's belong to? So bevacizumab inhibit VEGF and it's fundamental for the angiogenesis. So for the bevacizumab, it's about the red one, right? In the hallmarks, you can see the red one, the inducing angiogenesis, okay? Yeah, correct. Tamoxifen it compete with the estradiol and at the receptor called estrogen receptor ER, right? So tamoxifen inhibits the estrogen receptor. So it also similar to the EGFR. It's about the inhibiting the sustaining proliferative signaling. So it's also a green one, right? Okay. And another student talking about the chemotherapy, the AZA, RRC, and the cyclophosphamide, and the methotrexate, right? They are chemotherapy. You know, for chemotherapy, because they have non-specific mechanisms, usually they interact with the DNA or RNA. So they kind of inhibiting the cell cycle. So it's correct. But it might involve other hallmarks as well. Okay. Any other example? Okay. So if you don't have, then I will try to demonstrate some. Okay, let's come to a new one. Yeah, it's olaparib. It's PARP inhibit. Yeah, it's a very good example. So it's about the deep blue one, right? It's a PARP inhibitor and involved in the genome instability, and it's about the DNA damage repair mechanism. Okay. Yeah, the crizotinib is another example. All this crizotinib is targeting EMO4 ALK. It's also similar to the EGFR signaling. Okay. Yeah, the cetuximab is also an antibody. It's not a small molecular inhibitor. It's a monoclonal antibody and directly target the EGFR. Okay, so it's also it can be the green one, the sustaining proliferative signaling hallmark. Okay, so let's go to the next. Okay, in the last about for 10 minutes, I will try to give you some examples and the real practice in the real world, and let's try to connect the cancer from the bench to the bedside. Okay. So here is the top cancer drug last year. You can see the ranking. Although you don't know much about this, but I just want to give you a hint that these drugs all can corresponding to the 10, one of the 10 hallmarks in the right panel. Okay. So first is the most the ranking one on the most sold drug is Keytruda. It's pembrolizumab. And it's a anti-PD-1 antibody. And as we mentioned earlier, using this antibody, they can block the PD-1 and block the PD-1, the checkpoint blockade can wake up the T cell from the energy in the exhausted status to the reactivation of the T cell, and then the T cell can free to kill the tumor cells. So it's about the hallmark. Which one? The close the pink, the color close to the pink. Okay, this one. Avoiding immune destruction. Okay, so the next is the Imbruvica. It's a B cell receptor signaling, and it's a BTK. Here you can see the BTK in the cell. So it's also kind of this BTK is very important, the kinase signaling in the B cell lymphoma. So when we use this Imbruvica, this drug, we can target the BTK and block the signaling, the proliferation signals. So it's also kind of the green one, like the EGFR inhibitor. It can block the sustaining proliferation signal. Okay. Okay, the third one, the drug is the, it's the palbociclib. It's a CDK4/6 inhibitor. Okay. So for the CDK4/6 inhibitor, we have palbociclib, abemaciclib, and ribociclib. And using these three drugs with the same similar mechanism, we can block the CDK4/6. And we know the CDK4/6 is important because they can bind to the cyclin D and trigger the cell cycle. The cell cycle from G1 to S phase. So by block the CDK4/6, we can stop the cell cycle in the G1 phase, not going to the proliferation. Okay. And then we come to the bevacizumab, the one the student also has mentioned. Very great. Here is the bevacizumab, it's Avastin. And we know this drug, because you know the in the tumor cells, the blood vessel is become very abnormal, distorted. But when we use this kind of anti-angiogenesis therapy, they can normalize the blood vessel and have the better efficacy of chemotherapy to go in. So usually the Avastin, the bevacizumab, it's usually a combination with the other anti-cancer drug like chemotherapy to have a much better efficacy. Okay. Okay, then we go to the Tagrisso. It's the osimertinib. It's the third generation of EGFR TKI. So it's very similar to the erlotinib, like the one of the students mentioned. It's also kind of EGFR TKI to block EGFR. Although this drug is very, very potent, much, much potent than the erlotinib, because it's a second, it's third generation TKI. And here we can see it block the EGFR, activating EGFR with the common mutation like deletion 19 and the T790M. The amino acid substitution and the L858R. Okay, so this drug targets the EGFR signaling and block the proliferation signal. Okay, so here is the pertuzumab and the Herceptin. Both the two drugs target the same growth factor receptor, the HER2, but different, a little bit different. The trastuzumab target the HER2 alone, but pertuzumab it can target not only HER2 but also HER1 and HER3. So nowadays, the breast cancer, when we have the patient with HER2 positive, we usually give the dual blockade by using both Herceptin and the pertuzumab, and they can potent the anti-cancer efficacy. And again, they target the HER2 receptor and the blockade the downstream signaling. So it also belong to the this one. Belong to this one. Blockade the sustaining proliferation signal, the green one. Okay. Okay, so okay. Okay, the last example is the olaparib. It's also one student mentioned this It's very good to hear this. It's olaparib. It's a PARP inhibitor. And why it works? Because the PARP inhibitor, they can block the PARP to fix the double strand breaks. And in some certain condition, for example, in the BRCA mutated cells, they have no ability to fix double strand breaks. So in the BRCA mutated cells, when we use this kind of drug, the PARP inhibitor, like the olaparib, we can block the PARP and then makes the single strand break get worse to double strand breaks. And because the BRCA mutated cells have the defect to repair the double strand breaks, so it can eventually go to cell death. So that's why this kind of drug they doesn't approach, they cannot apply to every patient. They have to apply to the cancers, the tumor cells with the defect to repair double strand breaks. For example, the cancer cell with BRCA mutation. Okay. Thanks for everybody to join this lesson and give me very good example. And I hope you can have a basic understanding of the cancer. And let me know any question. Don't be hesitant to contact me. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, doctor.
Okay, thank you.